Hi everyone. A lot of you have been submitting YouTube comments, and a lot of you guys have questions on prostate cancer that you would like us to ask Dr. Scholz. And today, we're going to answer those questions. So Dr. Scholz, we've categorized some of the questions that we've gotten on YouTube, and today we would like to cover a whole lot of them, but the first category, we're going to be talking about risk. So I'm just going to go ahead and read our, you know, prostate cancer patient comments verbatim, and then you can go ahead and we can hear your answer. So our first question is that this person read an article on the internet back in 2008, and that it said that people who had hip x-rays have a 2 to 5 times more likely chance of developing prostate cancer. And he's concerned because his father's been diagnosed with prostate cancer at 68 years old, and he's now 36, and he had a hip x-ray, person who's 36 had a hip x-ray a couple months ago. And they want to know, because they're having a lot of anxiety, do they now have this increased risk of developing prostate cancer?
I don't think so. The family history, someone with prostate cancer who's, you know, whose dad is now 68, is typical for people to get prostate cancer that don't have a family history. So the risk with any family history does probably double. But the good news is that people who are going to be diagnosed with prostate cancer in the next 5, 10, 15 years, you mentioned he's 35 years old, the good news is that the advancements in treatment and diagnosis are getting to be so sophisticated and so effective that the risk of mortality is going to keep dropping and dropping, and the danger of nasty side effects is also going to be improving steadily. So I would just advise this person to check their PSA every year starting at age 40, and don't worry about it, that modern medicine is going to catch up more quickly than any cancer will. And I don't think the x-rays are going to translate into a higher risk.
Our next question is there any evidence of a needle biopsy leading to metastatic prostate cancer?
There is tiny evidence that prostate cancer can be left in the track of the needle where it goes through the rectal wall into the prostate and contacts the cancer and then gets pulled back. Those reports are exceedingly rare, but there have been occasions that that's been documented. The circulating tumor cell technology can show circulating tumor cells after a biopsy. So the issue, of course, is that you can see circulating tumor cells in people that don't have a biopsy. So we don't believe that the needle biopsies are enhancing the risk of metastasis beyond the risk that people already have because they have prostate cancer. And fact that about 1 million men are being biopsied every year and that the rates of metastasis have been steady for so long suggests that the needle biopsy is not impacting that risk.
We're going to go into active surveillance now. So a couple questions on that. How many biopsies are effective or needed during active surveillance? So what's the criteria of a biopsy being effective?
One question that comes up when you're doing random biopsies, I'm not a big fan of random biopsies, but they're still very popular. How many needle cores are necessary to do an adequate random biopsy? And with normal-sized prostates, the number is probably around 8. Typically, doctors are doing around 12. And then in men that have really large prostates, they need more than 12 to cover the territory of a big prostate. So the number of needle cores will go up or down based on the size of the prostate and also based on the beliefs of the doctor who's doing the biopsy. The other question would be, well, how frequently should men on active surveillance get random biopsies? And I think that random biopsies were for an era when we didn't have multiparametric MRIs, but there are many parts of the world where they don't use multiparametric MRIs, and even in the United States, unfortunately, they're still not doing MRIs instead of biopsies. But for the places that are relying exclusively on biopsies to do active surveillance, the general feeling is that a random biopsy should be repeated every 2 to 3 years, assuming that there's no new bumps felt on digital rectal, that the PSA is not misbehaving, periodicity of the biopsies should probably be about every 2 to 3 years.
So you kind of answered this already, but the next question is really, can an MRI be sufficient so you don't have to have a biopsy whatsoever in active surveillance?
Well, the academic literature would contend that no, that if you're going to do active surveillance, that you should do random biopsies. However, there are head-to-head studies comparing the accuracy of random biopsies with MRIs, old-fashioned MRIs, showing that the old-fashioned MRIs are more accurate than the biopsies are. There was recently an article in the New England Journal of Medicine that very nicely outlined that if you have a good MRI and a targeted biopsy, that it will miss small, higher-grade lesions about 5% of the time. And therefore, some have advocated that people have both a targeted biopsy with an MRI plus a random biopsy to be 100% sure. In my view, the argument against that is that we already know that we're overdiagnosing prostate cancer, and we don't want to even become more thorough at finding little tiny cancers. I would suggest just rely on the MRI and then perhaps repeat the MRI annually, assuming, of course, you have access to a quality MRI center. But that's an opinion. The real standard that's being utilized throughout the urology world is to do random biopsies.
Our next question really comes into the tissue samples that they're getting from a biopsy, and it's in 4+3. So the question is, can you discuss the importance of one tissue exam being a 4+3 versus, let's say, six or more being 4+3s?
So tumor volume, how big the tumor is an important thing to know, just as tumor grade, how aggressive the tumor is an important thing to know. And those are separate indicators, separate metrics that doctors use to estimate the chance for spread. Bigger tumors spread more easily and higher grade tumors spread more easily. So you can see that you could have a small high-grade tumor, a large high-grade tumor, a small low-grade tumor, and a large low-grade tumor. So you have four different categories. And the grade is more important than the size. So doctors are always looking first at the Gleason score. But then as a secondary issue, they look at how big it is. And it may be just if it's bigger, there's a chance that there are other high-grade elements that are being missed. Because remember, the biopsy is only sampling a small section. And so it may be all about grade, but just that bigger tumors have more hidden areas of higher grade disease. So it's not all entirely clear. But when people are estimating the chance for spread, which is what drives how whether people need treatment and how aggressive the treatment should be, they're looking at both of those factors, the grade and then the size of the tumor, which we're looking at indirectly with a random biopsy, because if you have six cores, unless you're putting all six cores in the same place, that you have a larger tumor because it's spread out more throughout the gland.
So when you say small versus large, how do you as a medical oncologist measure that?
Well, if you're doing an MRI, you could just look at the maximum diameter of the spot, the lesion that's being detected. So small lesions are probably 5 to 10 millimeters. Medium-sized lesions are perhaps 10 to 20 millimeters. You get above 20, 25 millimeters, you're looking at something more than an inch across, so you're getting into the large category. And then, of course, you get beyond that, patients that have cancer that's literally growing outside the prostate or into the seminal vesicles.
So from a random needle biopsy, they can't tell the size of the tumor?
Well, they put the needles in a grid pattern. And so, and if it's properly done, they'll label what part of the prostate each needle came from. And then, so if you have a half a dozen cores spread out over the right side, and all six cores have cancer in them, you can assume that the tumor extends from the top to the bottom of the gland.
Our next question is quite intriguing to me because it's two different sides of the coin here. So what if you have a Gleason score of 9, but a PSA of 0.65? So you have a really high Gleason score and then you have a really low PSA, and I don't think that's a common thing, is it?
No, it's not. Having a very high Gleason score is not common. Having it paired with a very low PSA it happens. It's not super common. Typically, people like this are diagnosed because someone could feel a bump on the digital rectal exam. So this is one of the arguments for why when people get annual screening with PSA testing, that the doctor should also do a finger exam. PSA is going to pick up 95% of the prostate cancers, but you can have low PSA producing cancers that might be felt with a finger exam. And I presume that's how this person was diagnosed. So low PSA producing cancers, they have argued are that they're somewhat more dangerous than ones that produce normal amounts of PSA. That may simply be because there's a delay in diagnosis. PSA didn't go up, so no one did a digital rectal, and then the disease turns out to be more advanced when it's detected. Or it may actually be a biologic variant that the types of cancers that don't make as much PSA are a little bit more dangerous. Gleason 9 is already what we consider a high risk, therefore it's dangerous, but it's still curable. And the idea of having a very low PSA at the same time it's well understood in prostate cancer circles. It is a minority situation, but it happens.
You as a medical oncologist being this prostate expert for 25 years, I mean, do you suggest that all men get digital rectal exams then, including on top of the PSA? Because I've had people ask me, should I just get the PSA test then?
Well, some people have argued that because men detest digital rectal exams so much that they may be unwilling to show up for the PSA test, that they can skip the digital rectal exam. And if men are bound and determined to avoid a digital rectal exam, I would certainly feel bad if they didn't get a PSA test. If the digital rectal exam scared them away and they didn't get a PSA test, then that would be a big loss. But for the men that want to be thorough and careful and ensure that something isn't missed, they should have a digital rectal exam once a year as right along with a PSA.
So our next question is, how dangerous is Gleason 10?
It's more dangerous than other types of prostate cancer, but that's not saying that much because a lot of other types of prostate cancer are not dangerous at all. It's curable. Gleason 10 is curable, and it depends on how high the PSA is, how large the tumor is, has it spread already. If you look at localized Gleason 10 with a PSA less than 10 to start with, and it's not a big tumor that you can feel with your finger, cure rates are well over 50% with radiation and hormone therapy. So it's still curable. It's controllable for many years in the men that aren't cured. But that's not like an intermediate risk where the cure rates are 95% with a Gleason 10. And a low PSA that isn't too large, the cure rates may be in the 75 to 80% range.
Which is still rather high compared to a lot of cancers.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think we get so many people that call us and they see Gleason 10 on the pathology report and obviously there's an immense amount of fear, especially when we're talking Gleason 6 to 10. Mm-hmm. And I think that talking about that cure rate is really important.
Yeah, there's already a lot of fear even in the men that have Gleason 6.
Right.
And so the idea that it's not only prostate cancer, which people are afraid of, but it's a bad type of prostate cancer, then it incites even more fear. It's certainly to be respected and needs to be treated with expertise, but it's still curable.
Right. I think another point that I would like to talk about is the fact that when you have Gleason 10, your treatment and going on treatment is a lot more rapid than Gleason 6 because prostate cancer is slow growing naturally. Is Gleason 10 even slow growing, or do they need to deal with it right then and there?
It's slow growing compared to pancreas cancer and lung cancer and brain cancer, but it's faster growing than a Gleason 6 because those don't grow at all. So
right.
Depends on what you compare it with.
Right. Thank you guys so much for commenting on our YouTube videos. We really appreciate your questions, and it's an honor to be able to answer them. If you would like further information about any of the topics that we talked about today, you can visit our website at pcri.org. If you haven't already subscribed to our channel, please do so. You can hit the subscribe button below. And if you have more questions, go ahead and leave them in all of our YouTube comments. Our team will pick it up from there. We hope you have a great week.